the chair. I hope you didn't mind my bending your ear. This torch that I found must be drowned, or it soon might explode. Make it warm for my baby, and one more for the road.
This is listener-supported public radio, KKJZ Long Beach, Los Angeles, and KKJZ HD1 Long Beach, a service of California State University Long Beach. Also worldwide at jazzandblues.org.
This is listener-supported public radio, KJazz, 88.1, and streaming online at jazzandblues.org. Steve Tyrell riding around with you from now until 8 o'clock tonight when it's time for Bubba Jackson. That's BWB. You don't want to go anywhere. Bubba will be bebopping you and beyond till midnight tonight. We're going to start this last hour off with Brother Ray, and he's making whoopee.
Another June, council meeting, and today's date is May 8th. Welcome, everyone. Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God,
Can we have a roll call, please?
Mayor Masalovic?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Vera Papa?
Here.
Councilmember Deaton?
Here.
Councilmember Moore?
Here.
Councilmember Sestarsic?
Here.
All present.
Thank you. By motion of the City Council, this is a time to notify the public of any changes to the agenda and or rearrange the order of the agenda. Are there any items that council members would pull? Nope. Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to presentations.
Mayor Maslavin, if I could briefly read into the record an item that was received regarding the agenda after the distribution of the agenda.
Yes, of course.
And that was an email communication to the City Council regarding questions that were posed by Councilmember Moore on various items.
Okay, thank you. Our first presentation this evening is from the Naval Weapons Station, Greg Smith, who is from the Naval Weapons Station Public Affairs Office, will be presenting a PowerPoint presentation. Thank you, Craig, for coming by.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, City Council members. Does this actually work for me? Oh, great, thank you. Okay, so I was here a little bit more than a year ago at that time to kind of let everybody know, hey, here's what we're thinking of doing with the weapon station port area. So over the last year since that time, we have been working on an environmental assessment for that project. And what I'm going to be giving to you tonight is kind of go over the background again really quick for those of you that weren't here the last time, and then go into some details about our findings and then the next steps in this process. So let's see. And I'll also kind of talk about this imagery a little bit, too, here. This is a guided missile destroyer being loaded at the Naval Weapons Station of Warp as it currently is right now. Destroyers like this one are the most common sight at our warp. There's more destroyers than there are any other type of a warship here at the weapons station. So some background on the base. So we serve a majority of the Pacific Fleet. Next nearest weapon station is an actually beautiful little island called Indian Island, which is in Puget Sound, about 50 miles from the Canadian border, so obviously very, very far away from the fleet concentration down in San Diego. We've been kind of growing the Pacific Fleet over the last few years as more ships move from the Atlantic Fleet to the Pacific Fleet to support our interests in Asia, and also the size of the fleet in general is scheduled to increase as well overall. So we're going to be having more ships to support. And finally, the base was built during World War II, and most of the structures are beginning to show their age on the base. So a little bit more about our ammunition wharf. Built in 1953, before the advent of modern earthquake codes. Too small to handle larger helicopter carriers, what we call LEHAs and LHDs, and I'll show you an image of one of those in just a second here. Also too small to support the loading of two medium-sized ships. We used to be able to support the loading of one medium-sized ship and one small ship at the same time, those small ships being frigates. However, we decommissioned most of the frigates. In fact, we decommissioned all of the frigates now. And so our primary surface warship we service here is now a destroyer, which is larger, and we can only service one of those at the same time. And finally, anybody that has ever used the small craft channel that goes right by our ammunition loading wharf knows of our security concerns there with the wharf being in such close proximity to small boat traffic. So this is a what they call an LHD. It's a type of amphibious assault ship. It carries helicopters primarily. And this is the larger type of warship that we're looking to try and service at Seal Beach someday that we cannot currently service. So the proposed project would be to build the wharf inside the current breakwater. This is in a very stark contrast to a proposed project we had that never really got off the ground in the early 1990s, where we would have built breakwater and the jetty out about, I think it was like two-thirds of a mile further into the Pacific Ocean and kind of wrapped it around surfside a little bit. This project maintains everything within the current breakwater and within the current base footprint. Of course, constructing the modern earthquake code is very important. And as I said, the ability to support larger ships or two medium-sized ships, and having a new small craft channel that that moves the small craft a lot further away from our operations. So here are our proposed alternatives. Let's see, do I have a laser on this? Okay, cool. All right, so here's the no action alternative is how things kind of look now. So our wharf is right there, and civilian small craft come from the ocean right through here, hopefully take a turn right here, and then go down and into Huntington Harbor, which is on the other side of the PCH Bridge, which is right there. So that's our current setup. We had three alternatives, and it's really two separate ideas that get moved around depending. One is the location of the new proposed ammunition pier, which for these two alternatives is right here, and for the third alternative is right here. And the second is where the new small craft channel goes. And as you can see, this one, it has it inside the breakwater right here, which frankly is not optimal for our security. But instead of having about a six-second reaction time, there would be 30 seconds to a minute reaction time for our sailors, which is much, much, much better than we currently have. And then, as you can see, the small craft channel is outside the breakwater here. Here it's pretty much snuggled up right next to the jetty. Here, because we have the pier itself is going to be closer, we have to also move everything kind of down this way a little bit. To keep our security and safety buffers at the required limits. So that means that this also has to move closer to surfside, the small craft channel, and then we have breakwaters here or here for the new small craft channel. So those were all the alternatives that were moved into the study, and we ended up picking a preferred alternative, that is this alternative, alternative one. Some other things that I didn't mention in the previous slides is we would build a causeway across here, obviously, so we can get to the ships and load them and unload them with munitions. We'd also be taking away a part of the inner mole right here. That's to create a larger turning basin in order to get those ships in and out. And then finally, one thing that is not shown on the slide, but that some of our residents will appreciate, is we have a number of barges that are currently in this area right here. Those would have to be moved to make way for the turning basin. Those barges would end up likely somewhere down here, but out of sight for most folks along Seal Beach Boulevard and Seal Way. Okay, so on to the environmental assessment. How am I doing for time? Am I okay on time?
You're fine.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So the environmental assessment, here's the issues that were addressed. It's a pretty standard environmental study. I don't think there's anything really surprising here that we either did or didn't look into. These are pretty much standard items. So I'm going to divide this into two sections right here on what the findings were in the draft environmental assessment. First is during project construction. Biological resources, marine mammals was a key area of concern, and we would be having wildlife monitors in place and would stop construction if any marine mammals, and that's anything from whales, dolphins, seals, you know, sea lions, that sort of thing, were in the project area. And then the other biological resource issue is eelgrass beds. Some of those would be reduced because of the increased size of the turning basin, and so we would replace those in other areas of Anaheim Bay to make up for them. Noise, pile driving would be the primary noise source, but as you can see here, by the time we're far enough away from homes where the noise would pretty much be at background traffic levels. We've had a lot of pile driving actually that goes on in the past. Over time, we've had to replace piles at our current wharf. We probably do that about once every 5 years, I'm guessing, and it could be anywhere from a couple of dozen to like up to 70 piles that we're replacing at one time. And we've not gotten any noise complaints from those operations, so I'm fairly certain that that pile driving would not be a concern to area residents. Finally, boat traffic. That's another concern we've had from the boating community is they want to make sure that we're not going to be having to stop boats coming in and out of Huntington Harbor for an extended time during this construction project. And the answer is we'd phase it so that the first thing that got built was the new small craft channel, and then we would kind of switch on them and then build the causeway to block off the old small craft channel after that. So project operations, this is after construction is complete and we're actually using the ammunition pier. Ocean circulation is a key one, especially concern of the folks that work on the wildlife refuge, and that would actually improve because of the more direct access to the ocean. Same for both Huntington Harbor and the National Wildlife Refuge. View, we know, is a big issue with some residents, and I mean, some, the views from some homes would definitely be blocked when some types of ship are in port. There's just no way around that. Beach erosion, the project would not impact beach erosion, and the primary reason for that is we're keeping everything inside the jetties and not building anything outside that would impact beach erosion. And then air emissions would increase because we would have more ships coming in and larger ships, but the increase will be fairly minor and within the AQMD's emissions budget. So where are we now? When I was last here giving a presentation like this, we were in this phase right here. We had a public scoping meeting at Mary Wilson Public Library a little more than a year ago. Now we're in the draft environmental assessment phase. That was opened on April 14th. It's going to run through the end of May, and the public comment period during that time. Public meeting is going to be held a week from tomorrow at the Marina Center from 4 to 7 p.m. And we certainly invite everybody here to attend if they'd like to learn more about this project. I've got a lot of general information, but there will be lots of subject matter experts there at that meeting. From that worked on all individual aspects of the environmental assessment. Okay, so finally, once the public comment period is over at the end of May, then all our staff gets back to work. They work on finishing up the environmental assessment based on the comments that we receive from the public and from the regulators as well. And then sometime in early 2018, right now, if I had to guess, I'd say around March 2018, we will release the final environmental assessment. Only at that time, once the final environmental assessment is out, will the Navy make a determination on whether to move forward with the project or not. If the Navy decides to move forward with the project, then you've got to get funding in place and pick a contractor and all that good stuff. The earliest the construction would happen would probably be like 2019, but more likely 2020. So that's all I have. Does anybody have any questions?
No, I don't. Councilmember Deaton.
Yes, ma'am.
I know that you have looked at it extensively, but on alternative three, that's the only alternative where you have the pier that's parallel to the existing pier.
Yes.
Is it possible to put that pier parallel to the existing pier in alternative one?
No, it's not, and I'll show you why. Let me get back here. Okay, the primary reason for that is we're required to have certain standoff distances between our munitions operations and members of the public. We kind of got grandfathered in the way it was, the way it used to be, but if we build a new project, even if we rebuilt this pier in the same place right here, we would still have to worry about that issue. So putting the small craft channel through here, this is where the public's going to go. This gives us enough standoff distance right here. If we have the pier parallel like this, we can't have the small craft channel that close. We have to push the small craft channel outside the breakwater. And then, of course, to protect the boaters, we'd have to have a new breakwater right here. And that would open up all sorts of concerns from local residents in the surfside area with loss of the access to the surf on the beach, et cetera.
But my concern more is with alternative one.
Yes.
And making the pier parallel to the existing pier today.
Oh, I see what you're saying. In order to do that, then there would not be enough room for the turning basin right here to get the bigger ships in. If you have it, if you'd have to have it either going down this way or up this way. If it goes up this way, you lose your turning basin radius. If you go, if it goes down this way, then you have to push all this stuff further down that way.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
It's just visually, it looks like it could be done, but I know that there's actually engineering involved.
Yeah, believe me, it would actually, if there was a way we could make that happen, we would want to do it. One of the things we have to do if we have it in this position is we have to have a breakwater right here, and that costs us more money as well.
Is there one there on alternative three?
There is one there on alternative two. There isn't one here on alternative three, and that's because by putting it right here, you wouldn't have any wave action. Whereas, you know, here you're kind of pointed right into the surf, and so you need a little bitty breakwater right there.
So I guess, Greg, what confuses me is it looks to me like you could put that just the way it is on alternative three.
I'm sorry, I don't understand what you mean by just the way it is.
So if you just flip the pier around.
So you're talking about taking this pier here and putting it on this side?
No, I'm talking about on alternative one, staying with alternative one, and flipping the pier and moving it just like you've got it on alternative three so that it kind of backs up into the causeway.
Okay, right. If we did that, then we would have to push the public access channel further this way.
Because of the
Of the safety buffer zones.
Okay. Oh, you prefer to call it safety buffer. Okay. That's all. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Any other questions?
How much more frequency, how many more ships would be coming in after this project?
That's a good question. We, on average right now, we service about 40 ships per year, although that number can vary widely. Last year, we were down a lot. Just because of the way the fleet was rotating and the way that they were sending their ships overseas. This year we'll be a lot closer to that. We probably would never do more than about 60 ships per year, and that would be an extremely busy year for us post-project. I think what you're really looking for here is not only, you know, current operations, but your ability in a crisis situation to be able to surge more ships overseas quickly, and that's what the two ships per, you know, at the same time gives us, which is not a current capability that we have. But I can't imagine us going over 60 ships per year once the project is built and once the fleet is to the larger size that it's going to be.
How many more sailors are on one of those aircraft carriers versus the destroyer?
A destroyer on average will have anywhere from 250 to 325 sailors on board. And one of the larger amphibious assault ships, like the small aircraft carriers, they'll have about 1,000 sailors on board.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Sure.
Council Member Vera,
I have a question. Thank you, Mr. Smith. How much longer is the LHDs compared to the current ships that are in there, the longest ship that's in there?
The longest ship that we service right now, and it's one that anybody that's driven by and seen it will remember, it's called an LPD. It's another type of smaller amphibious assault ship, but it's the big one with the cones instead of masts. That's the biggest ship we currently service, and it's nearly 700 feet long. It's about 690 feet long, I believe. The LHAs and LHDs, the helicopter carriers that we would like to service, they are about 160 feet longer, I believe. They're at about 545 or 555 feet long. I'm sorry, 855 feet long.
You addressed the piles, and that came up at our school district meeting, and I know we'll be addressing that more when you know more about it as far as the number and the capacities and stuff like that, so I won't dwell on that. But you didn't really mention much about the surf and the surf break affected by any of this. Is that going to be affected in any way?
No, and as a matter of fact, we did a study on sand transport and surf conditions and everything, and that's one of the reasons why we chose alternative one over the other two, because the other two alternatives would have impacted surf on the surf side of the jetties, but because we're keeping everything inside the current breakwater, the surf would not be impacted.
So in alternative one, the breakwater stays where it is currently?
And under alternative one, the breakwater would not move at all.
And how long are the ships usually in port there, roughly?
Normally what we try to do is try to always have the sailors home for weekends. So generally a ship will leave San Diego Monday morning. come up and arrive sometime Monday afternoon, and we try to get them out of here by Thursday afternoon or Friday morning at the latest. So you're talking probably an average of 3 to 3.5 days per ship.
All right. Well, thank you.
And there can be two ships at once.
Yes, there can, but one has to be small. We can't have two medium-sized ships at the same time right now.
Right now. What does that mean?
I mean, is the current way the wharf is, our current wharf can only take one medium-sized ship and one small ship.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Anything else?
Anyone else?
No, I was just going to ask the question about how long they were in port. So you would have 60 up to 40 to 60 ships in port for 3 or so days. So I was trying to figure out how many days
is
a year the views are blocked. Yeah.
And it would depend, you know, in the view thing, that's an important factor. It would depend on the type of ship as well. One of the things I'll tell you we're kind of working on right now, just to give you an idea, is the folks along COA probably already know this, but when we have a ship come in, we don't have it used, like put it right in the center. We actually have it, well, I should use this since this is our current wharf. We don't have the ships like right here. We put them up on this end of the wharf. And we do that for operational reasons, because all our trucks come in from here to load things onto our loading dock, and it's just a lot quicker to have the ship right next to where you're doing the loading versus having it, loading, you know, if the ship was right here, for example, having to move everything all the way down the other end of the wharf. Our truck turnaround area is right here, so it would make more sense for us from an operational standpoint to have the ships on this side versus right in the middle or more towards this end. I think that will help a lot with view issues as well for a lot of your residents. One last thing to remember on the view issue is that, one of the bigger helicopter carriers, I mean, that thing is a big block, and that will block the whole place and everybody's views, and nobody can do a lot about that. But those ships will probably only be in maybe 4 times a year for like 3 or 4 days. The average ship is a destroyer. And for those of you that know what destroyers look like, it's kind of like, you can kind of divide the ship into thirds. The front third and the back third are pretty flat and pretty low to the water, and then the middle third is where the superstructure is. If we can get the superstructure of the ship kind of more towards this area right here and not like way over here, I think that would do a lot, again, to eliminate a lot of view concerns with some folks.
I had one other question. About a week ago or so, you had this real pointy looking ship out there. What's the official name for that pointy ship?
If it's the one, was it the Trimaran one?
Yeah,
that was USS Jackson. That was an Independence class littoral combat ship. It's the first time we've had one of those here.
And how would you describe that front end of that thing? That was just
really pointy. Stealthy. Those things just look like the future.
Yeah, it was kind of cool.
Yeah.
Like a better word. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg.
Okay. Thank you, everybody.
Very informative. And don't forget the meeting next week.
I'll be there.
I know you will be. So will we. We're going to celebrate the Runseal Beach Fastest Resident Award. This proclamation will be presented by Deb Manchin from the Runseal Beach Group, and she will be showing a video. Hi, Deb.
Hi, thank you. Honorable Mayor, Council Members, City Manager and staff, my name is Deb Manchin, and I'm a Seal Beach resident and Secretary for the Board of Runseal Beach, an all-around snappy dresser tonight. And I'm here in place of Greg Phillips, our president, who's home with the flu. So good wishes to him. I am here tonight to thank the city and the city manager and staff, and in particular, Tim Kelsey, Chief Joe Bailey, and Chief Joe Miller, for all of the help that you gave us to make this such a successful event. In addition, I'd like to thank our generous sponsors, our volunteers, and the community in general for helping us to make it, again, a successful run. Run Seal Beach is a volunteer-run organization raising funds and awareness for local recreation and programs throughout the community. And the event was held on April 8th, a month ago, and featured a 5K walk and run, a 10K run, and a 1K fun run and kids fun run zone. We had over 4,000 runners and walkers registered and nearly 3,500 finishers on race day. We started with a rainy day. I know a lot of people in this room were there, and it looked like it was going to be a bit cold and rainy, but it blew over for us, and it was a sunny, beautiful day, and everybody had a really good time. Our grant request period will be closing on May 15th. So if you are a qualified nonprofit in the greater Los Alamitos School District area, which includes Seal Beach, Los Al, and Rossmore, you must submit a complete application by online using our form at www.runsealbeach.com no later than May 15, 2017. Now I'd like to share a short video presentation showcasing this year's event with special thanks to SBTV3 for video clips that are used in it, captivating photos, and Kevin Edwards for photos used within the video. Thank you. The guy at the end there was our oldest registrant, and he was 90 years old. He was the absolute last person in and ran the 10K.
Wow. Good for him.
Pretty impressive. Come on over. I think we are it for the board tonight. This is Michelle Samuelson, and she's in charge of the kids' run and the kids' fun zone and, well, things all throughout the year. So together, we wanted to announce that we will be awarding $120,000 this year, touching countless residents, students, servicemen, and others who are served by our community. So we're very excited by that. And now we are ready for the presentation.
Well, okay. Do you want to do it?
I would love for you to come down if you can.
Okay.
Okay. While Mayor Massalavitt makes her way down, we have a plaque in City Hall upstairs by the Recreation Department that is in perpetuity, and each year the Seal Beach resident winners of the 5K and 10K, both male and female, names are added to that plaque. Tim couldn't be with us tonight, and we don't have the name. We like to show the nameplates, but we don't have those tonight. But they will be added to the plaque very soon, and we would like to celebrate our Seal Beach winners. And they are. The male resident winner of the 5K is Nick Musser with a time of 19:32. Nick, are you here? Our Seal Beach female resident winner of the 5K is Macy Buell with a time of 22:19. Our Seal Beach male resident winner of the 10K is Lorenzo Tyner with a time of 38:07. And finally, our female resident winner of the 10K was not able to make it tonight. Something came up at work, and she called me just before. Jenna Crawford with a time of 41:21. So can we get a photo? Did we want to get a...
Congratulations. And they'll give you your award soon.
Actually, it will go. Forever.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, our next presentation is Drowning Prevention Awareness Proclamation of 2017. This proclamation is presented in support of the OCFA, and that's Orange County Fire Authorities, Always Watch Your Child Around Water, and Never Swim Alone campaigns. OCFA will launch a 24-week water safety campaign in May and will run through October. Drowning is the leading cause of death and disability in California for children under the age of 5 years, and a major problem for adults aged 35 to 64. As a result, there were 16 fatality drownings and 12 non-fatal incidents for adults in 2016. If OCFA Battalion Chief Matt Levescu could come up, We have a proclamation for you.
Thank you.
The City of Seal Beach would like to present you with this proclamation in commemoration of Drowning Prevention Awareness, a month, or 6 months. There you are. Would you like to say
yes,
a few words?
Thank you very much.
Good.
Well, good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the council, staff, and members of the community. My name is Matt Levesque, and I'm a battalion chief with the Orange County Fire Authority. It's my honor to stand up here and accept this proclamation. I'd like to take just a couple minutes and talk to you about drowning prevention, some facts, and some tips on preventing that. In 2016, I know you already stated some numbers, but we have some other numbers. There's 106 drowning incidents in Orange County. 39 of those were fatal. You'd already mentioned that drowning is the leading cause of death for children under the age of 5, and in reality, children can drown in as little as 20 seconds. In May through August, drowning rates nationally increased by 89% when compared to other times of the year, and it is recommended that adults and children always swim with a buddy, regardless of their ability to swim. We recommend that you instruct parents, babysitters, caregivers about potential pool hazards and emphasize the need for constant supervision of children. And if a child is missing or unaccounted for, we recommend that you always check a pool or a spa first. Do not use flotation devices as a substitute for supervision. And always remember that water wings and floaties and inflatable water rings and other pool toys are not safety devices. And always be aware of your child's location and whereabouts of all children. Drownings happen everywhere, including bathtubs, mop buckets, toilets, pools, spas, ponds, and even standing water. Children can drown in literally as shallow as 2 inches of water. In addition to parental supervision of young children, designate a water watcher, someone who will maintain constant watch over children in or near the water. The water watcher's job is to watch the water at all times. It's not to participate in the activities. It's not to have conversations. It's to be that person, that responsible person who can sit there and watch the water to ensure that all the people that we care about are safe. We also recommend that you install and maintain proper barriers around the pool to isolate your swimming areas from the home and play area. Use multiple layers of protection such as safety covers, gate alarms, door alarms, or motion detection devices, and always make sure that all gates are self-closing and self-latching and open outwards away from your pool. And finally, we recommend that you learn CPR, first aid, and rescue techniques. It's amazing how a small amount of education can go a long way in saving a life. Thank you for this proclamation, and thank you for this opportunity to speak to all of you.
And thank you very much for coming. The Federal Emergency Management Agency, known to all of us as FEMA, they prepare the flood map updates, and our Region 9 representative is Edward Curtis, and he will be presenting a PowerPoint presentation. Welcome, Edward.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the council. I appreciate the opportunity to give you a brief update about this mapping project that we're involved in, not just for Seal Beach. Includes all of the coastline of Orange County. It also actually includes all of the coastline of California. So I'll give you a little background about why FEMA is doing this study and this update of our flood insurance rate maps. A little bit about the methods that we're using, where we are in the process, and what the next steps are as we move forward towards updating and then eventually finalizing these new updated flood insurance rate maps. Just to put it in context, FEMA flood insurance rate maps are one of the components of the National Flood Insurance Program. Congress established the program in 1968. To provide a method for property owners, structure owners to be able to purchase flood insurance that wasn't at that time available on the commercial insurance market. So there's really three parts of that program. FEMA produces flood insurance rate maps. We produce maps for the entire country, and they show areas of what we call special flood hazard, high-risk flood zones, if you will. Communities like Seal Beach adopt and enforce a floodplain management ordinance to with the goal of reducing flood risk to new and existing development. And then the third part of that process is that the federal government makes flood insurance available to the property owners in these participating communities like Seal Beach. Just as a generic example, what does a flood insurance rate map look like? This is the format that we're using nowadays. On the right-hand side, that's an example of the paper map. We've zoomed in a little bit. But generally, what I want to get across here was the blue shaded area. When we talk about special flood hazard areas or flood zones, a lot of terminology, 100-year flood zone. You'll see me using the term 1% annual chance flood zone. That's another way of thinking about or describing a 100-year a risk at the level of a 100-year flood. So that's the area that FEMA maps and designates on our flood insurance rate maps as the high-risk flood zone. A lot of our mapping is done in inland on rivers, streams, what have you. We call that riverine flood mapping. This is unique. This is coastal mapping. So the only information that we're providing on the updated maps that's different from the maps that are currently in effect is along the coastline. So we call this part of our Open Pacific Coast study. It's part of one of two major flood studies that our region, FEMA Region 9, located in Oakland, has undertaken. It's taken several years. You'll see a timeline for the Orange County study. One of them is the Open Pacific Coast study. The other one is a specific study for San Francisco Bay. There's a website on wwr9coastal.org that's a good representation, gives a lot of background, provides a lot of meeting minutes, copies of slide presentations that we've done at various meetings that we presented along the way. The Open Pacific Coast study covers all 15 counties along the Open Pacific Coast of California. Phase one started about a year earlier than the phase two work that we're doing now in Southern California. A lot of information here, but this is an overall timeline for the work we're doing in Orange County. We kicked it off back in January of 2012 with a kickoff meeting. This will just kind of give you an idea about how long it takes us to move through this process to get from an initial kickoff to what at the end would be our final effective maps. We're estimating right now that for the Orange County maps, including Seal Beach, we'd be finished with the process and the maps would go into effect in July of 2018. In between, we've moved through some early versions of the work maps that we presented to the communities, the coastal communities in Orange County in March of 2016. In September of 2016 last year, we issued the preliminary flood insurance rate maps that are the subject of the discussion tonight and held a couple of meetings for all, again, for the Orange County coastal communities to present those maps. Some of the slides that you'll see tonight are some of the ones we used at those meetings. The timeline, we moved through the early phases of the project where we were acquiring new data, doing our analysis of the flood risk, tides and waves. Then we developed our initial maps. We transferred that information. We put it into the preliminary map form. Now we're in what we call the post-preliminary process because we've issued the preliminary maps. A key date that's coming up is June 9th. We're initiating a statutory 90-day public appeal and comment period for the maps. That's an opportunity for the community of Seal Beach and for individual citizens, property owners, to provide comments to FEMA on the maps, and then it gives us an opportunity to review those comments and appeals, make determinations about whether we need to correct any of the information that's on the preliminary maps before we finalize the maps. Tentatively, we're estimating that by January of next year, we would finalize the maps, send the community a letter that says 6 months from now, the maps will go into effect, and that puts us into July. Briefly, I'll talk just about the coastal study process itself. What we're trying to accomplish is to determine what would be a total water level that any location along the coastline of Seal Beach would experience during what we would consider the 100-year or the 1% annual chance flood event. So it's a very extreme flood situation. It's not something that would occur every year. On average, once every 100 years, but that's only an average. So, and it certainly is not the worst case flood event. There certainly could be a more severe event, but this is our standard for determining a high-risk flood zone. What we're interested is what's the worst combination, if you will, or the 100-year combination of a high tide event, what we call a surge on top of that high tide, which could be a combination of atmospheric pressure, wind, and an El Nino condition that is going to raise the water level higher than normal high tides. And then significant waves that are going to what we call run up on a relatively steep shoreline. And the ranges here that you're seeing, 5 to 7 feet for the tides, 1 to 4 feet for the surge, and 10 to 50 feet, that's a really extreme condition, would combine to result in what we would call a total water level, or on our maps, we use the term base flood elevation. A base flood is a 100-year flood. And when shortly after we did the kickoff meeting, we sent teams out to do walk the beach, if you will, talk to communities, get information about structures that provide protection either for erosion or flood. That would be used in the analysis. We needed the most up-to-date topography and bathymetry, the mapping of the shore and the undersea, the underwater topography near the shoreline. We had the advantage of being able to access information from the California Ocean Protection Council and some federal agencies, NOAA, the Corps of Engineers, and USGS. Who had been very actively collecting that information in the 2009-2010 timeframe. So we had pretty good up-to-date information for the entire California coast. Skipping a few steps, but what we get to is, and this is for the shoreline of Seal Beach, we draw and survey a series of what we call transects. They're numbered transects. This happens to be 1 through 7. We locate the transects at strategic points along the Orange County coast. There's a total of 88 transects along the entire Orange County coast. What we're interested in is capturing areas where there are unique shoreline characteristics, changes in the way the shoreline is oriented and the way it's exposed to the storms, and other conditions, situations like land use and development. Just briefly, these are the specific locations where we do the detailed wave analysis. We don't do it continuously along every yard of shoreline. We're limited to some extent by funding for this kind of a project. It's very expensive, but we're actually going back 50 years and recreating the history of the tides and the waves at these specific locations, and then analyzing during those 50 years at an hourly time step, what the wave condition would be and what the inundation condition would be. We analyze that data and do statistical analysis to pull out what the 100-year level flood risk would be. Then we transfer that information to our maps. I mentioned the blue shaded high hazard area. We call those flood zones, and we give them labels. A VE zone, V stands for velocity in the FEMA mapping world, but that's an indication that there's not just a condition of flooding, but it's also accompanied by wave action. And the wave hazards, I'm sorry, typically those are, I talked about wave run-up. Depending on how extensive the wave run-up is, If we're talking about wave run-up on some kind of protection shoreline structure like a seawall or a dune or something like that, if it's a high enough run-up, it'll overtop and the water, the flood will extend past the protective seawall or what have you and extend some distance further inland. Sometimes beyond the VE zone, where there's a less risk of wave hazard, we map that still as a 100-year flood zone, but we'd call it an AE zone. We also have zone X areas. If it's shaded, and we now use an orange color on our maps, that would be an indication that is an area that would be flooded or inundated by a 500-year or 0.2 annual chance flood level. So it would take a much higher level flood event, but it doesn't have. But it's a much more rare, unlikely occurrence. Significant here is that in zones VE and AE, under the National Flood Insurance Program, there's a mandatory flood insurance purchase requirement for structures that are located in those areas. Just briefly to talk about that flood insurance requirement, I want to read it because I want to get it right. When a structure is in a high-risk flood zone and that structure has a federally backed loan or mortgage, then the owner of that structure is required to purchase flood insurance. There are options. NFIP is not the only game in town. That's the federally provided flood insurance program. Other insurance companies do provide flood insurance, but it is a separate policy. It's separate from a homeowner's insurance policy. Homeowner's insurance policies don't cover flood. So if there's a flood insurance requirement on a structure, then the lender is going to require their mortgagee to obtain a flood insurance policy. Annual premiums are set nationwide, but they vary between structure to structure based on the flood zone, that AE, VE. They're not required in X zones, but they are available in X zones at a lower rate because the risk is lower. There are different premiums for residential and non-residential structures. Age of the structure, when it was built, compared to the time that the flood insurance map first went into effect, makes a difference. And a key thing is the height of the lowest floor of the structure when it's compared to the height of the 1% or the 100-year flood elevation. The higher the floor above the height of the flood elevation, the lower the premium. I'll just give a quick example of I mentioned these transects. Number four happens to be in this location along the Seal Beach coastline. This is just a visual representation of if you looked at an aerial view where that transect would be located. You can see this is, again, this blue flood zone. We've mapped in this between these two locations, these white lines, gutter lines. We're characterizing that as a zone VE, high-risk flood zone with waves, and the elevation of the flood, 100-year flood, would be 24 feet. That's measured from a vertical datum, sea level, but the more better definition or better description is a North American vertical datum of 1988. Surveyors like to use vertical datums and not sea level. This is another product that we created. This is not part of the regulatory flood insurance rate map, but it's a visual representation that shows what the changes are between the new flood insurance rate map that we're producing now versus the one that's currently in effect for Seal Beach. We've shaded it with the orange to indicate it where we've increased either the height or the extent of the special flood hazard area. Green is where it's decreased. Blue is where it stayed the same. A lot more orange on this map than green. A lot of that orange is in the Naval Weapons Station. Previously, we did not map any flood hazard on the naval base. Because it was federally owned property, we've changed our policy on our flood insurance rate map, so we now are providing that information. So because it's new, it shows up as orange. Harder to see on this map, but we provided this information to the city, to the Public Works Department, not just in paper format, but in digital format, in GIS, GIS shape files. It's a very good tool that the city can use. I'm aware that they are using it this way to zoom in very closely to see particular which parcels are actually affected by these maps, where we've actually increased, if you will, the area that's covered by special flood hazard area, where structures that were not previously shown in high-risk flood zones now have been added to that area. Just to wrap up, where we are, I mentioned we're getting ready to initiate this 90-day public appeal and comment period. This is a statutory requirement anytime we change flood insurance rate maps. The way it's done, again, by statute, is that we publish two notices, legal notices, in the local paper. The date of the second notice is the start date of the 90-day appeal period. The city public works folks have been working with us to plan for a public meeting June 15th. I don't have any specifics yet on location or time. It'll probably be an evening meeting. But we'll be working to support the city. I'll be there. A couple more FEMA folks will be there, including an insurance specialist, so that we can provide, again, a brief presentation and then answer questions and help people locate their property on the flood insurance rate map so they can see if their structure is being affected by the changes. So part of that process is for us to put a notice in the Federal Register that we're that notice is already published. Now we're publishing the public notices in the paper, and that again that initiates the formal appeal period. After it closes, we'll review all the comments we received and make determinations about whether we're going to make any changes to the maps, whether we're going to accept the appeals and comments, or if for some reason we may deny them. And then move forward to the next steps in the process to finalize the maps. From the community side, again, we're working with folks primarily Public Works. They've been already in the process of reviewing the preliminary maps that have been available now since September of last year. We know that they will be submitting comments. We're expecting them to submit their own comments to FEMA. When we met with them in September, we invited them to consider how they would provide outreach to the public, because FEMA is very limited in the way in our public outreach to the legal notices in the paper. We know that's not the most effective way to reach the public, but it is kind of a limit that we have. That's literally the limit of our capability to do public outreach on the scale providing new maps to the entire state. And we're going to support the community to help communicate the information about and awareness about this new mapping. Let's see. I think that's the last of my slides. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Are there any questions? Yes. Councilmember Dayton?
Well, this happens to affect my district, so I have quite a few questions, if you don't mind. It was an excellent presentation. I think you've answered some of the questions that I've been writing as we went. But what I would like, you talked about, yes, there are different zones that have different rates, and, of course, then it comes down to each structure is evaluated. So there is a difference in the rate structure between AE and VE.
Yes, there is.
And if you do not have a federally backed mortgage, you do not have to have flood insurance.
That's correct. The mandatory flood insurance purchase only applies to structures that have federally backed loans or mortgages.
Okay, and I'm concerned that I was just given maps last week or the week before, but you're saying they were out in September?
Yes, ma'am.
And have you walked our beach?
I have, actually. I wouldn't say I've walked every bit of it, but when I was here for some of the earlier meetings, I did go out on the beach.
Okay. I'm just asking because the Gold Coast, if you stand there and you look out, it's like, where's the water? You know, I mean, it's a very long walk. And those houses are now, many of them, in this new floodplain, so it looks very odd to me that that we would have a flood that would come in that far. So it's kind of interesting. If you were not identified in previous maps, but you're now identified, will it have more effects on you than just an insurance premium? Will
yes.
there be new? What, okay, go. What?
Yes, there are requirements under the city's flood ordinance that regulate development in the high risk flood zones. In a VE zone, typically the requirement for new construction is to elevate the structure on a pile foundation that's open underneath the structure so that the 1% chance flood and the waves pass underneath the structure and the waves don't come into contact with the structure itself. So that's a little different from the requirement in an AE zone. There's still a requirement in an AE flood zone to elevate the lowest floor of the structure at or above the flood elevation on the flood insurance rate map, but there's not a requirement for the open foundation.
So, okay, we have homes on Seal Way that have been built up so the water can go under, so that's an old thing that was done early on.
Mm-hmm.
My concern is more with the AE flood zone, where now we have a parcel that may be 18 inches, 2 feet higher than its neighbor. Does that increase the flood chance for the neighbor next door?
Generally, no. I would say no. Generally, the footprint of the building, you know, if the building was there previously and it's just been elevated to a higher level, it's really more the boundary of the structure itself than the height of the structure that would have any effect on the neighbor's property. So if the building was there before and the footprint hasn't expanded, then probably there's not a difference or change to the level of flood risk to adjoining properties.
Except that you'll have a house that's next door to you that's over the top of you.
Yes.
Did you include any measurements for sea rise?
No, we did not. We don't account for future flood risk conditions on the FEMA flood insurance rate maps. We call it a current condition flood insurance rate map. We call it a regulatory product or regulatory map because it's used to regulate development and it's used to set flood insurance premium rates. So it's not considered fair, I guess, if you would, to the property owner to require a purchase of flood insurance for a future flood hazard condition or a higher flood that might occur in the future because of sea level rise. We know that there are similar products being produced maybe by other agencies. They're a good planning tool, and I would really encourage the use of that kind of information for planning, but because FEMA is making, again, a regulatory flood map, we do not look forward into the future about what the future risk is.
Okay, and then I believe you said this, but I can't remember. How often do you revisit these floodplain maps?
I'll give you two answers. It's been about 30 years since FEMA has updated the coastal maps for California and actually for the entire United States coastline. That's too long, but it's a very expensive process, so we had to wait for Congress to provide the funding and the initiative for us to do this nationwide coastal map update. In the statute, the Code of Federal Regulations that governs our mapping, we are required to review every 5 years our maps to determine if conditions have changed that would warrant an update. We don't usually update our maps on a five-year schedule, but we are required to do that review. So we have a process in place to to monitor that every year, and we keep track of our maps on that basis. So this is a, I don't know if it'll be a once in 30 year type process for us that we won't come back and update the maps, but I anticipate it may be several years before you do a similar update. It is possible to do updates to relatively small areas of the coastline instead of doing a restudy of the entire coastline. So if conditions change along a certain area, or if there's a major project, for instance, a new seawall or a new some type of flood protection project, we would work with the city or the community that's managing that project to do a letter of map revision that could go into effect in a relatively short period of time as an interim measure before we would come back and do the complete map update.
All right, thank you. I understand that you can get a letter of map reduction, that it's quite expensive to hire a surveyor to get that done. Do you have ways around that to help the homeowners?
Let's see. We use the term letter of map amendment.
Amendment.
L-O-M-A. We like our acronym, so it's a LOMA.
Okay.
But a letter of map amendment. We don't charge a fee once an application's been submitted and we review it. So it's not a FEMA fee, but you're right. There is an expense to the structure's owner to bring in a surveyor to determine the elevation of that lowest floor compared to the elevation of the flood elevation on the map. In some cases, lenders do put a requirement on a property owner to ensure that the structure, when in fact the flood zone doesn't touch the structure, it only touches the property. In that case, the property owner can submit an application for the LOMA without a survey, and we just do the visual comparison without, because we're not basing it on elevation, we're just basing it on where's the boundary versus where's the structure. We call it an out as shown LOMA, and there wouldn't be a surveyor fee involved in that. So out as shown.
All right. I think that's really, really helpful, because I was talking a group of homeowners last week about this, and most of them would be an out as shown LOMA. And then I was told that the surveying fees in order to get a LOMA could be $3,000 to $5,000. So that's a lot of money to ask someone to put out to try and prove that they're not in this. But most of them were out as shown. They weren't trying to prove that it'll hit us, but not by that much, type thing.
Yes.
I noticed when I looked at some of the maps that some lots were affected a lot more than others were, to even their next-door neighbor. And when you're using what you called transects?
Yes, ma'am.
It's possible, I'm gathering, that's just a mathematical thing and not a real thing. Am I guessing at that, or am I?
It's certainly a mathematical calculation. There's many equations and calculations involved that have to do with the elevation of the water level. The beach slope at the location where the waves come on land and run up the slope, and that sort of thing. We're using that transect location to be representative for several hundred feet perhaps on either side. So once we determine the flood elevation at the transect, we will then develop our map, draw our floodplain boundary. Based on that flood elevation, but once we look at where that location would be on the map at the transect, it may vary because of the difference in ground elevation on either side. So different lots could be affected differently, even though the flood elevation is the same for all of the lots in that along that stretch of beach.
Well, I was really shocked when I looked at one particular lot because almost half of it was in this new flood plain, and it's, I don't know how long it is to the beach. I get tired walking all the way out there. So, I mean, it's a long way to get to the water, and yet a good half of that lot is in it, and yet not the next door neighbor. So is there a, would you say that that homeowner should definitely ask you to look at their property individually if they find that they are more in the flood zone than anybody else?
Yes, I would. I would encourage them to submit a comment to FEMA if they're able to come to the public meeting. There'll be representatives both from the city and FEMA to look at that. You know, look with them on the map and look at their lot and discuss that with them. We can. You know, but they don't have to come to the meeting. We're going to ask that the city collect, receive those comments from the public and then forward them on to me at FEMA. Sometimes we do get comments directly from the public and we can accept them either way.
Right. Okay. Two more things and then I'm kind of out of questions. The first thing I'd like to say, would you leave your slideshow with the city clerk so we can have a copy of it?
It
was excellent and well done. Thank you. And then the last thing is I want to thank you for holding the public meeting. I think that'll be really important. And I was wondering if you would mind, when you're done, maybe just hanging out in the lobby for a few minutes, because I know there are people here that might want to ask you some questions, and we're going to go on with our meeting. So if you wouldn't mind just hanging out so that anybody that's here might want to ask you questions specifically.
I'll be very happy to do that.
All right. Thank you so much. And, again, thank you for coming. I appreciate the time you took out of your schedule to come, and thank you for holding the public meetings. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Curtis.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, this is the time for oral communications. At this time, members of the public may address the council regarding any item within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Pursuant to the Brown Act, the council cannot discuss or take action on any items not on the agenda unless authorized by law. Matters not on the agenda may, at the council's discretion, be referred to the city manager and placed on a future agenda. Those members of the public wishing to speak are asked to come forward to the microphone, state their name for the record. All speakers will be limited to a period of 5 minutes. Any documents for review should be presented to the clerk for distribution. I know that some of you are here to speak about the LA Fitness project. If you've already spoken before and have nothing new to say, then please hold your comments until there is a public hearing, and the Planning Commission will be again listening to what your comments are. So if you would like to speak, please do so, and we're ready for you.
Mayor Maslovit, if I could please add, if the speakers can clearly speak their names into the microphone so we can capture that. Thank you.
My name is Lois Corrigan, and I live in Leisure World, and this is regarding the fitness gym. And although I live in Leisure World, I have a very odd, unusual birth defect, which has required a number of surgeries over the past 3 years. So it's become really essential that I participate in either water aerobics or bicycle riding. A stationary bike for me, I kind of can't balance on the other ones, so that I can continue to walk. I'm not running in a marathon. I'm just trying to walk across the room. And I do use 24-hour fitness in Long Beach right now, but it's kind of a drive. And I went to a public meeting, and they showed that the gym is going to have an indoor pool and an indoor spa area and some of the other equipment that is common to a gym. So I'm excited and I would like to use that. Although Leisure World, the problem I found was that the pool was outside and it's cold and I don't want to go there. And I've had some real issues with the dressing rooms that were very difficult for me to manage, and I've just given up. I tried Cypress, 24-hour fitness. When they first came, I couldn't find parking. The pool, again, was just an issue that they didn't monitor it, and it was kind of useless. And I couldn't use a lot of the other equipment. I've tried some of the other rare places like Disability. There's a pool in Long Beach, but it was very small, and it was rather odd. And the same was true of another swim school in Long Beach. The one across from Long Beach LaSalle High School, when I checked into them, I was excited. I watched them build the whole thing. And then when I called, they're like, oh, yeah, the part for adults is outside. I'm like, you've got to be kidding. Okay, I'm not going to do that. That really isn't going to help me a lot. So I'm looking forward to being able to use the pool, use the bikes. Oh, another problem I found with Leisure World is that the bicycles, which I want to use later in the evening on Saturday and Sunday, they close at 5. So that kind of leaves a whole weekend that I tend not to exercise, and then by Monday I can barely walk. So I've been told they're going to have silver sneakers if I can fit it in to around water exercise. I'm going to try and do that. So I've been told there's buses running from Leisure World to them, to, you know, the shops. I actually still drive. So I just want to speak in favor of that fitness gym.
Thank you. Next. Janet.
Good evening, all. My name is Shion Switzer, and I'm here on behalf of the Steel Beach Chamber of Commerce. Just wanted to highlight some upcoming events in our community. But before we do that, we just recently concluded the 30th annual Steel Beach Classic Car Show. So I wanted to say a big thank you to the council members and the city staff and all of their employees for the great coordination in working with the car show. A big thank you to the Steel Beach Police Department and all of their activities coordinating and on the day of the event. Thank you to the owners and staff at Tank Farm here on Main Street. Did a great job of putting on a classic motorcycle show, another component for the car show. Thank you to Greg Smith and the leadership at the Naval Weapons Station. They provided us the last few years with the opportunity to have all of our visitors park on the base and under the coordination of the service members. So thank you so much. I can't imagine the car show without that benefit. And then finally, for those who don't know, the car show is entirely staffed by volunteer members of the Chamber of Commerce. So well over 100 are required just to put on the show that day. So special thanks to all of our chamber members who volunteered and made the show a great success. So we aim to highlight the businesses and all of the attributes of the city with the car show. And it's a great, great, great season this year. So thank you all. Couple of upcoming events. Just wanted to let our council members know that we would love to have you attend the Chamber Member Mixer this Wednesday evening, starting at 5:30 at the Temecula Olive Oil Company, located on Main Street. 5:30 again, if anyone's available, we'd love to have you, council members. For the public at large, we have a couple of big events coming up. The Chamber's Be More Healthy Expo is coming June 3rd down by the pier in Eisenhower Park. It runs from 9 to 3 Saturday. So come on down. Everyone is welcome. Kids, families, all that good stuff. Focus for the health fair is healthy minds, healthy body, healthy finance, healthy business, even healthy pets. So there's something to do for everyone. So come on down and take a visit. We also have a couple of exhibitor spaces still left open. If anyone has a business they'd like to highlight to the local community, we'd love to have you. Next exciting event that people wait all year for, the Chamber's Summer Concert Series is coming up. It starts July 6th, which is a Wednesday, and then it runs every Wednesday for 8 weeks thereafter, concluding on August 24th. The concerts are held down in Eisenhower Park, adjacent to the pier. They're from 6 to 8 on each of those Wednesdays, and everyone is welcome, so come on down and enjoy. We have some new bands coming this year. And we have some old favorites returning, like the Elm Street Band, and cover bands for both the Beatles and U2. So those are always big favorites, so we welcome you to that event as well. And I think that is everything. If anyone has questions on any of those items that I've mentioned, feel free to visit the Chamber's website at stillbeachchamber.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Shannon. Next.
Hi there. I'm Julia McConaughey, and I live at 235 Seal Beach Boulevard. And I really appreciate Mr. Curtis coming and explaining the FEMA remapping project. Our concern is a little bit more urgent than his timeline in that we live one house away from a house that's now being built at least 2 feet, maybe 4 feet. Right now there's 4 feet of dirt. We're taking into consideration that may compact down. They're building two homes there, significantly higher than either house on either side. I can't imagine that they won't have flooding into those yards. And it will also cause equity issues. They're going to have a different view than the houses that are already there. There's going to be blocking of natural light. We already have very little of that. As soon as the sun goes over our house, all the lights come on in the house, which then you get the electric bill. Done letter saying you're using too much electricity. So I really would like that the city would consider whatever is going on with this mapping as a precursor, if it's going to not be a part of the map, or if it is a federally backed loan. I think those only go up to $750,000. That's $1.5 million neighborhood. So if we can, at of all costs, avoid having two houses 4 feet higher than the houses on that street, we would appreciate that for all those reasons that I mentioned. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, distinguished council members, and city staff. My name is Vanessa Widener. I'm a resident of Rossmoor. And I am actually here to speak in opposition to the LA Fitness. And while I know you've already heard quite a bit about it, the reason I wanted to speak tonight is because I brought my two children with me, my daughter Ava and my son Dean, who both are in the Los Alamitos School District at Weaver Elementary School and McCulloch Middle School. And I hope what I have to say might resonate with you a little bit as to how it will affect not only our lives, but other children in our community. Seal Beach is Mayberry by the Sea. Rossmoor is a wonderful bedroom community as well. And one of the wonderful things about Rossmoor is that you can ride your bike. And my kids ride their bikes all the time. And they ride their bikes to the shops at Rossmoor all the time. They love to go to Rite Aid and get a scoop of ice cream. They go to the library all the time to check out library books and read. They'll go to Chick-fil-A and get a lemonade. And one of the only ways into the shops at Rossmoor that provides a bit of a buffer from what is traffic and congestion, we can all see that, is coming in through the back near the Sprouts where the proposed LA Fitness is going to be. So while you've heard a lot, and I'm sure you'll hear a lot more, and I appreciate your time this evening and really the opportunity is to speak, I just felt compelled to bring my kids and just let you know the people who it will affect. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Next. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Okay. Welcome. That'll bend down. The mic will bend down. Go ahead. Push. Yeah. There you go.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor, City Council. My name is Jessica Bay. Thank you for taking time to listen to me. I would like to address the LA Fitness Gym project. I would like to ask you to reconsider if you have already decided to move forward with the project. I think you should know that it will have a negative impact in our community. It will increase traffic. It will make it difficult for me and my friends to walk to the library, go to Yogurtland, and Toys R Us. I don't think it's going to be a safe place to walk freely. I'm afraid that the gym will attract crime to the neighborhood. Besides creating more traffic, the gym will also affect our air quality, noise, and people parking in our neighborhood because there won't be enough parking. I also believe it's going to keep children from walking to school because they will be afraid of random strangers and getting hit by speeding cars. Thank you for listening, and thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
I have never been here before, but I am going to talk about LA Fitness very briefly.
Could we have your name first?
It's Carlene Brines, B-R-I-N-E-S, and I do live in Rossmore. I've actually built two homes there. And I just wanted to show you the reason I'm here. This is when they started school. At Hopkinson. This is my children now. Safe and sound. It's all about kids.
Could you speak to the council, please?
It's all about kids today. Safe and sound. This is so worrisome, really. If there's a little bit of teetering, please rethink this about the kids. They're not going to be safe. I see them riding their bikes. They're happy. It's all going to go away. Because people will see the community we have built. And my kids are not afraid of anything. I don't want them to be afraid. This kid, my oldest boy, William Brines, is going to go in the Marine Corps. He is studying and getting his education and will go into the Marine Corps. He has wanted to do that since he was this age. For us. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Board. My name is Beverly Houghton. I'm currently the president of the Rossmore Homeowners Association, and I would like to share this letter that we have written Share the letter that our board of directors has written and submitted to the Seal Beach Department of Planning and Development in January of this year regarding our concerns of the LA Fitness project. The Rossmore Homeowners Association has reviewed various plans and analysis for the LA Fitness Club project at the shops of Rossmore and has serious concerns about the adequacy of the parking and traffic analysis. We would like to file these comments for the EIR. The RHA has long worked with adjacent cities, the Los Alamitos Unified School District, and the County of Orange on traffic impacts within and outside our community. The county and the school district have undertaken extensive and costly efforts to mitigate traffic congestion during school hours, which impacts not only Rossmore residents, but many Seal Beach parents who drive their children into one of Rossmore's four elementary schools. We are concerned that the analysis of this high-volume retail establishment could reverse the improvements that the school district, the very district that serves your city and the county, have undertaken. At its own cost, the school district has begun a program offering low-cost bus service to Rossmore schools from Seal Beach and has cited about 200 families that are subscribing to the service every day. The health club is almost certain to add many more vehicles trips than that to Rossmore streets. We are particularly concerned about increased traffic volumes on St. Cloud and Montecito roads, which carry large volumes of vehicles to Rossmore Elementary School, as well as Weaver School and Hopkins Elementary. This also is the main pedestrian and bicycle route to the schools. The city must require developers to improve the analysis of how future patrons will access the club. The main entrance seems to be westbound on Rossmore Center Way, an access road that is already congested from serving a large number of retail stores at the front of the complex. One serious potential problem is that visitors to the sports center will find an alternative route through Rossmore, accessing the club eastbound on Rossmore Center Way or from a freight entrance at the stop sign of Corpo de Oro. Either route would cause serious traffic problems during school hours. Moreover, the freight entrance does not appear to be properly engineered for general traffic, even though it would provide access to the club. The other issue of serious concern is the informal agreement that the shops of Rossmore make to allow Seal Beach residents in nearby apartments to park in the lot that is slated for development. The accommodation relieves the problem of the Seal Beach residents' apartment parking in Rossmore in front of private homes. If this accommodation is lost, Seal Beach must find a solution to the overall parking fund from the, in front of the apartments. The RHA has heard overwhelming opposition to the development of the health club. While we believe economic development in many cases is a positive for our community, we want it to be done without impairing the safety of pedestrians, congesting our residential streets, or causing overflow parking into neighborhoods. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Come up.
Good evening, Mayor and Board. My name is Bertha Dela Cruz. I live in Rossmore. I've been there for about 24 years. This is my first meeting here. So about 2003, when Rossmore Athletic Club closed down, I was very sad, very depressed, because I really like going to the gym. I've been a gym goer for all my adult life. Aside of that, when the Rossmore Athletic Club left, I had a choice to make, and that was either go to LA Fitness in Garden Grove, 24-hour fitness off of Catella, or Frogs in Long Beach. And there were a couple of other ones, but I decided to go with LA Fitness in Garden Grove. And if this project goes on, I'm not so sure if it's a done deal or not, but I thought I would come to the meeting. I'm very, very busy, but I thought I'd come to the meeting to find out how far along are we. Well, if this project goes up, I will not stop going to the LA Fitness in Garden Grove. That's where I'll go. I think that this will be a big mistake. I have the hours here for LA Fitness over in Garden Grove, Monday through Thursday, 4:30 in the morning to midnight. Friday from 4:30 to 10 p.m. Saturday and Sunday from 7:30 to 8. I continuously have to watch my purse. Cars are being broken into every week, right in the dark, right in the daytime. I know there's some police here, and they can verify it with LA Fitness. There are no cameras out there, and the gym refuses to put them up. So when anybody works out, it's at their own free will for whatever happens. But it's a matter of what is in the best interest, what I always ask, in God we trust you have there, and that's what I do every day. So what is in the best interest of Rossmore and Seal Beach? And I think it would be a big mistake. I really do not shop at the area because there's so many people, the parking is bad, and I know that we would be affected big time. But please review or look into all the break-ins in the cars, the people that would be coming in. It doesn't mean that more people are going to work out. I can tell you that. It doesn't mean that. And it doesn't mean we can not only look at the money for a profit. We run a business, and I know it's very, very important for us to make a profit and make money. But the reality is that too many people in that little congested area, it's way too much. It would be different if it was spread out. But this is, I don't think it's in the best interest of Seal Beach and certainly not Rossmore. Anyway, thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next.
Good evening. My name is Tim Payone. And at the risk of being the least popular in the room, I'm here tonight to speak on behalf of CP Shops at Rossmore, the owner of the center, and to discuss very briefly LA Fitness. And we're not here to debate any issues whatsoever. We simply want to share the message that we understand that the neighbors have concerns. We understand that they want us, want LA Fitness to be a good neighbor, and we want the same. The shops at Rossmore has been here for decades and has been a good neighbor and a good member of the community, and we intend to continue down that path. We do want the council to know that when our time before the Planning Commission arrives, we are going to present a lot of the facts and issues, as we should, as we're compelled to do, that might tell the rest of the story that you do need to hear. We're really here tonight because we've observed the, you know, obviously the community input to you repeatedly, and we just want you to let you know there will be more to the story. We will address the issues. These issues are fair and legitimate for the neighbors to raise. They need to be addressed. That's on us, and we hope to do that when this matter gets to the Planning Commission. We've reached out to the community through a series of open houses. We've listened to the comments that have been made here. We understand the community's issues, and we want to respond, and we will. An EIR has been prepared for the project this time around, which didn't happen last time, to address all of these very issues. So there will be a lot of information in front of you, in front of the Planning Commission when the time comes, and perhaps ultimately in front of you as well. What we found out there during this time is, yes, there are a lot of people, like these good folks here, who oppose the project. There are also a lot of people who are very supportive of the project because it will get them the opportunity to pursue, you know, fitness and health a bit closer to home. Not everybody's the same, and there are many, many opinions out there. In the end, we have confidence that the Planning Commission will have before it a record which will objectively demonstrate that the LA Fitness Project will, in fact, be a good neighbor and will not produce the problems that many of the neighbors have concerns about. While we fully understand that those concerns need to be addressed, we simply ask that there be an open mind. We're not going to engage in a debate here during your public comment session. That's not the purpose. We simply want you to know that when the project reaches the Planning Commission, there will be more information and there will be another side of the story. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak?
My name is Steve Havens, and I live in Kempton Drive, and I live in Rossmore for many years. Mayor Pro Tem, council members, thank you for the opportunity to speak. I just wanted to comment, since the gentleman came up here in favor of the LA Fitness Center, and I just wanted to review some issues regarding strategic plans. And we all know that companies today are very focused on strategic plans because the landscape is changing quite dramatically. And if they want to remain in business and they want to maintain their profit plans and their sales plans, they constantly have to look forward and ahead. So I just wanted to review some of the landscape today with respect to strategic plans with this LA Fitness Center and the shopping center and the shops at Rossmore. The situation throughout the U.S., shopping malls are failing, retail is failing. L.A. Business Section on Sunday, 4/30/2017, reported 60,000 retail jobs disappeared in the first 60 days of this year. Online shopping has exploded. Jeff Bezos, the CEO, founder of Amazon, is probably going to be the richest guy in the world shortly. Traditional retail failing big time. Examples: Sears, Macy's, Sports Authority, American Apparel, Payless Shoes, JCPenney, and on and on. Shopping malls have to rethink their whole approach on how to remain relevant. An interesting story from the Wall Street Journal in the last couple of weeks. There is a workout show put on by Fitness Blenders out of Seattle. They have 4 million subscribers. It's a workout show on YouTube, which is free, and it's put on, I think, in the morning and in the afternoon. They have more subscription memberships than 24-hour fitness nationally. The price, it's free. They're supported by advertising. So I recommend that you disapprove the LA Fitness Center. Formulate a committee of stakeholders from Seal Beach residents, Rossmore residents, Los Alamitos residents, the developer, and come up with a strategic plan where all the stakeholders are present and think about what it's going to take to keep this shopping center relevant. The LA Fitness Center doesn't work. We've heard over and over again for the last few weeks, traffic, parking, noise, crime doesn't add value. Value is lost by surrounding housing dwellers big time, to the extent that realtors are forecasting $10,000, $20,000 a residence. That's a big price to pay to bring in this fitness center. We don't need another health club in this area. There are plenty within driving distance and reasonable distance. Conclusion, the city needs to deny the LA Fitness application. It doesn't work. It has too many negatives versus the positives. The city needs a strategic plan to rethink a win-win approach for the developer, the city, Seal Beach residents, Rossmore residents, Los Alamitos residents. The plan should address what's wrong with the Marie calendars. How come that is not leasing? That's been vacant for 2 years. What is the problem? How to make the shops at Seal Beach more of a community experience, retail services, medical services, full occupancy. There should be an entertainment theme, and it should bring the community together.
1 minute, please.
Maybe the plan will emerge just by bringing people together in a positive way. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak?
Good evening, Dave Burgess. This is going to be redundant to some degree, but I've typed it out. I'm going to read it. Before consideration of the LA Fitness project, Seal Beach first needs to do a proper EIR on the whole 375,000 square foot shopping center versus the claimed 300,000 square foot shopping center that existed in 2000. Same with the traffic study. City of Seal Beach needs to find parking for the approximate 250 plus Seal Beach residents who will be parking on non-Seal Beach property. I'm going to interject. I travel to Seal Beach. I spend money in here. I park here. But I don't come down here and live across the street in a neighboring town and park in front of someone's Seal Beach resident house. It's not being a good neighbor. The city of Seal Beach needs to rectify the current unsafe conditions on the perimeter and the interior of the shops at Rossmore. Back to number one, need an EIR for what they're worth and a traffic study. Moving forward with the evaluation of the LA Fitness project with no prior action on numbers 1 through 3 above, including publicly issued plans and completion date, is irresponsible and quite possibly illegal. At the last week's meeting, Planning Commission, I asked for clarification on the public statement at the May 2016 EQ board meeting that there's never been an EIR done. I asked for the answer to that. I was told that they couldn't respond to me. Okay, not respond to me, but you could certainly direct me to who to communicate with. And I let it go. On Tuesday, 6 days ago, I sent an email to Steve Fowler addressing what I just stated above. I want to see the square footage in year 2000 and the square footage in 2017. Again, today, 6 days later, since I had received no response, I asked for a response again. I request that you urge your staff to respond to the public. On the square footage issue, the June 20th, this is redundant, the Planning Commission document stated 309,000 square feet. The Best Star website says 376,000 square feet. Marty Potts, the developer's JLL website, touts 430,000 square feet. I don't think it's 430,000. That's probably embellishment, but anyway, those are the facts. In addition to that, I sent an email to Martin Potts and the corporate of LA Fitness stating that personally I felt that their marketing, while business, it's a business, has both been non-factual and unethical. On the LAFitness.com website, where people are giving their support, which is fine, I also sent in there, they don't publish any contra comments. Okay, it's their website, their choice. But I want to read just one blurb out of one response that is very interesting and personally offensive. The opponents of this project are mostly Rossmore residents who want to control and maintain a parking lot behind their townhouses. Okay, the parking is behind our townhouses. Actually, they're Seal Beach townhouses.
1 minute, please.
They've used that property that is not theirs and are barking about it and bringing up excuses, i.e. noise and crime. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak?
Scott Ferguson.
If you'd speak and say your name into the mic.
Yeah. My name is Scott Ferguson. I'm a lifetime resident and the owner of Anytime Fitness is here in Seal Beach, owner and operator. Been here 9 years. Just wanted to quickly clarify on the Silver Sneaker matter. They've been putting out a lot of information, letters and whatnot that the only facility that offers that program, and it's just not true. We offer it. It is on our on the website, and we offer Silver Sneaker classes. We have all of the same equipment. We do not have a pool. I understand if people want to do that, but I just wanted to come and let everyone know that that is not true. We do offer it, and support your local business. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else wish to speak? Come up now.
Good evening. My name is Diane Rush. I'm a resident of Rossmore. And my main concern tonight is the process that this concern with LA Fitness Center has. Last year, the same exact proposal came before you. It was withdrawn immediately before it was officially voted down and then resubmitted, this time with an EIR attached, which from my experience, I would call political maneuvering. The California Environmental Quality Act, CEQA, is a statute that requires state and local agencies to identify significant environmental impacts of their actions and to avoid or mitigate those impacts. Well, both times the speakers have addressed the Environmental Quality Control Board, they were told that the issue of crime could not be encompassed in that EIR. Well, I can't think of any impact to the environment or the community that would be more important than crime. So if they're now going to say they can cherry pick what issues they consider and what they don't, I would say that whole thing, the whole EIR, is invalid. And in conclusion, I'd like to tell you that the Rossmore wall just got 10 feet taller.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak? Now's the time. Okay. Oral communication is closed, and we'll move on to the city attorney's report.
Mayor, prior to the meeting this evening, the council met in closed session regarding the three items on the posted agenda, took no reportable action with regard to any of the items.
Thank you. City manager report.
Yes, Mayor, thank you. Just have one item tonight. I'd like to call forward Commander Steve Bowles, who'd like to make announcement regarding an upcoming Seal Beach Police Department open house. Commander Bowles.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, Council Members, City Manager Ingram.
Good evening, Commander.
City staff. We've got some great news for you tonight. Saturday, June 10th, we will be hosting our Seal Beach Police Department open house. The hours will be 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the police department, conveniently located at 911 Seal Beach Boulevard, so nobody forgets where we are. We're going to have a station tours. If you haven't been by the police station or through the police station, one of our highlights of the station is, of course, down in our jail, and you'll be able to take some pictures down in the jail. We'll have a police helicopter be flying over, possibly landing somewhere around the police department where people can sit inside the helicopter. We'll have a canine demonstration, police motorcycles, police cars. We'll have our SWAT team will be there. They'll have their SWAT vehicles there. We'll have booths that will showcase some of our volunteer programs, the volunteer and policing program, our CERT program, our RACES program. Long Beach Animal Control will be there with a booth as well, sharing some information about their services they provide to the city. We'll have a booth by a former officer, Stan Berry, who does a Seal Beach Police historical display. We'll have multiple uniforms on display from the past 100 years. The Lions Club will be doing a free barbecue. We'll have hot dogs, chips, drinks. We'll have lots of great stuff. Naval Weapons Station Security, their police force will be out there as well. And, of course, we'll have a bounce house for the kids. So it should be a great day, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m., Saturday, June 10th. And we look forward to seeing everybody there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Thank you. Council comments? Council Member Moore?
I was excited to be part of the centennial time capsule ceremony on Saturday. Thank you to the committee that put everything together for that and everyone that attended. It was fun to look at items from 1969 and how different things were 50 years ago. And I'm sure it'll be fun 50 years from now for people to see what life is like now in Seal Beach. And I recently went on a tour of the Navy base, so thank you, Greg Smith, for the tour. It seemed like the idea of a community pool is being looked at very positively now, so that's exciting. I also enjoyed the Seal Beach Car Show, and the Chamber and the Seal Beach Lions did a great job at the event. Thanks.
Council Member Sestarsic.
Thank you. I also enjoyed going to the Seal Beach Car Show, and I also enjoy going to the centennial planting of the time capsule. So anyway, thank you to all the centennial volunteers, and thank you to the city, to Patrick, for helping with that nice event. Thank you.
Council Member Deaton.
Yes, ditto and ditto on the car show and the burying of the time capsule. It's always great to have our community events. But on a more different level, I would like to talk about the FEMA maps for a moment, and I would I don't know if you need a motion or just whether you need a council agreement or not, but I would like to ask if we could direct the city manager to hire a consultant to help us analyze the new floodplain maps. I understand Steve Miter, our new Public Works Director, has done an outstanding job of looking into this and kind of partnering with fellow cities and looking for a consultant in order to do this, because we want to give our residents the best break that we can. So I would, do you need a motion for that or just direction?
Just consensus direction.
Okay. Is there consensus that we, would we partner with other cities around that are interested in hiring a consultant?
Well, we would hire our own consultant to do our own work. It's going to have to be a house-by-house evaluation and stuff.
Okay.
So, no, we need to get it ourselves. But we will partner with other cities in how they're doing it so that we can look for the best ways to approach it. But the consultant that that Steve was talking to, Dr. Poon, which, let's see, where is this? Normally, people have a resume on a sheet of paper. He has a book. of a resume. And he voluntarily came out to a coffee that we held on the Gold Coast, because this will be the first time the Gold Coast would ever be in the floodplain.
Yeah.
So I think Steve knows what he wants to do. I just am looking for council direction to get it done.
Okay. Is there a consensus then that we hire a consultant to help with the FEMA map? Is there objection to consensus? No?
I don't have any objection, but I mean, is there a cost associated? Would we have that?
Yeah, we'd have to hire them, yeah.
I mean, it'd be nice to see it, something on paper as far as a fee and what
Steve, do you know
about.
What?
I mean, we're not talking
about
open book here, open checkbook.
Yes,
I don't need it right now, but I'm just saying.
Well, no, we got to get going, so you do need it right now.
The consultant we're talking to is working closely with Newport, so he's an expert on this, and he is an expert in modeling, and he's an MIT doctorate, so he's very specialized, and I asked him to go in there and do a peer review, and actually, you know, I think it's important to note the FEMA model you saw today looked at 1,000 miles of coastline, and I think it's prudent to go into a peer review on the 3 miles of our coastline. So he's going to go. He has the expertise to go into their models, and he told me about roughly $20,000 worth of consulting, being not to exceed hourly, not to exceed in that range, not to exceed $20,000, but that should be sufficient to go into the modeling, the maps. Some of the topography that he hasn't FEMA may not have considered, so that's going to produce a technical memorandum comment, and it would be submitted to FEMA, and then they would go back and look at the model and hopefully reduce the overall impact to our community. That's the goal. And I think after talking to FEMA, he's recognized by FEMA, so. That would be the plan, and he's estimating a not to exceed contract $20,000.
And his work would avoid the Loma.
His goal will be to look at the data and see how if there's, for example, that they may not have considered the berm, the revetment over at Sea Surfside. They probably didn't consider that because they don't know about it. But that's a permanent structure, so he thinks that's a legitimate go back and model this, and that could have some major impacts on the community.
Yeah. Well, I've been involved with Lomas before, and they are cumbersome, and I'd like to try and avoid property owners having to do one of those. So if we could get enough information out of him so that FEMA would obviate the need for a Loma, that would be great.
That's the goal.
Yeah. And would be a not to exceed $20,000 contract, and the city manager is allowed to sign a professional contract for that amount.
Mayor, I just suggested that the council's give a consensus that you're authorizing a consulting arrangement. You don't have anything else on your agenda this evening in that regard. So I suggest leaving it to the discretion of the manager and the public works director. If it's a matter that has to come back to the council for approval, they'll certainly they'll certainly do that. But I think they've got the consensus of the council.
All right. Then do we have a consensus, it sounds as though.
No.
Okay, then we can move ahead with that. A council member.
Thank you all very much. It's really important to our residents along the coast. The other thing that you didn't know from just looking at that new floodplain moves all the way into Ocean Avenue, not just on the surf. So it's amazing. So it's going to be a big impact on our folks. And that's why I asked him the question. It goes far beyond just buying insurance. It goes into construction. It goes into changing our codes. It goes into all kinds of things. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Councilmember Viera-Papa.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Mayor. I did attend the 30th annual Seal Beach Car Show. was a great event. I talked to a number of people that worked it. They were there at 4:30 in the morning, and they were there probably all day, as I was not, but I was there most of the day. I think I got over 10,000 steps that day. I was a judge. I got to be the judge in your place to select the Mayor's Trophy. That was a great honor and a great pleasure. So many great cars, so thank you. And on another note, if I can get a Marina Center update at the next meeting, maybe we can kind of just see what happened. I know we put a lot of money into that in the last year, in fiscal year, so maybe just some type of update on that. Thank you.
Thank you. I did attend the Southern California Association of Governments conference in Palm Desert for Thursday and Friday, and it was very informative, and glad I had the opportunity to go. And I did get to ride in an autonomous car, and it was pretty cool. And it stopped when people walked in front of it all by itself. And it was a pretty neat thing to do.
Brave people.
Brave people.
Brave people. Yeah. They didn't realize that it was an autonomous car. Yeah. There was no driver. There was no nothing. There was nobody going to control it if something went wrong. Very neat. The vehicle of the future, everyone. Okay, let's move on to council items, and there are no scheduled council items. We'll move on to the consent calendar. Do we have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
A second?
Second.
Please vote. Okay, passes. There are no public hearings. There's no unfinished and continued business. There's no new business. And we're going to adjourn to the City Council meeting Monday, May 22nd at 5:30 to meet in closed session if deemed necessary. Thank you all for coming, and the high school kids will be glad to sign off.
Robin, could I get up? A digital copy of the slideshow on the floodplain.